Hello everyone. In this video, we are going to discuss about the use of two important techniques, that is MIC and AST, in the field of research. In the earlier videos, I have told you how to perform the test and what is the importance of the test. By using both these methods, we can find out the efficacy of the drug, that is whether the drug is going to inhibit the growth of organism or not. So that we can easily make out whether the microorganism is sensitive to the drug or resistant to the drug. So compared to the AST, MIC is more accurate and more efficient because certain drugs may not diffuse through the agar media. So for that reason, we can go with the MIC, and it is the first step for the preclinical study to identify if any compound is having an antimicrobial property or not. Okay. How can we apply these techniques and where can we apply these techniques? For example, if you take a pharmaceutical company, if they are in process of developing a novel drug or a synthetic novel drug, what they do? They perform this AST to identify whether they are getting a zone of inhibition or not with AST, and to standardize the concentration of the drug by performing the MIC. Because in the MIC test, we'll come to know at what concentration the drug is inhibiting the bacterial population. So that least concentration will be considered as an MIC value for the drug. And this is how the pharmaceutical companies work with these techniques. And coming to the research side, for suppose in your laboratory you have identified a compound and you want to detect the antimicrobial property of that particular compound, and if you want to perform an MIC to detect the particular concentration where the bacteria is getting killed, you can utilize both these techniques. First thing is, you can go with the AST. If you get a zone of inhibition, that is very good. If you doesn't get any zone of inhibition, don't think that your drug is not effective. Your drug may not diffuse well through the agar media. Then also go with the MIC method, taking a different concentrations of the drug. For antibiotics, the concentration will be different, and for your drug, the concentrations may vary because you need to standardize the concentration of the drug. You take from the highest concentration and then you serially dilute it to the least concentration. If that doesn't work, you again move on to the highest concentration and repeat the experiment. If you are getting good results with the least concentration, then still you reduce some more less concentration. You still reduce the concentration and then again repeat the experiment. Okay. For suppose, if you are working with any medicinal plant like tulsi plant or a mint plant or any kind of medicinal plant, and if you have isolated a compound, how will you use the plant extracts? Like, to prepare a plant extract, what you need to do is first choose a source. Suppose if you want to apply these two techniques in research, that you are interested in identifying a compound with an antimicrobial property because you are more interested to eradicate the population of multi-drug resistant strains, and you want to come up with a very effective drug into the market. And the first important thing is, first you screen for the presence of antimicrobial property or not. That can be done with the help of these two techniques. If you feel difficulty, like in AST, you may not get promising results because your compound may have high molecular weight and it may not diffuse well through the agar media. Then you can also check with the other method called as MIC. First thing is, you need to choose a source, that the particular compound from where it is being isolated. It could be isolated from the plant source or from the any other source. If you are working with a plant, say for example that plant is having a medicinal property, that medicinal property is due to the presence of bioactive compounds, that could be a tannins, lignins, terpenes, phenols, flavonoids, like that. Plant will have a more number of bioactive compounds, and you have isolated a particular compound. For example, if you take a flavonoid, how will you isolate this particular compound from a mixture of compounds? For that, first step is to prepare plant extract. For the preparation of the plant extract, you can choose any part of the plant, whether it could be a leaf sample or it could be a root sample. or it could be a stem sample, or it could be a flower, it could be a fruit, or it could be a seed, whatever it might be, whatever you are interested in, or you can use the whole plant as well. Okay, and you want to identify the antimicrobial property of that particular medicinal plant. Listen how we can apply this technique in the field of research. Here you have chosen a source of one medicinal plant, and you want to detect, you want to isolate a flavonoid from that particular plant, and you want to check whether this flavonoid is having an antimicrobial property or not. So the first step is to choose a plant, and then you collect the sample from the plant, whether it could be leaf or you can choose the entire plant as well. Then chop the plant into a pieces. Okay, so if you collect the leaf sample, then cut it into a small pieces. Then you wash it thoroughly to remove the dust. Wash thoroughly to remove the dust. Then these leaves are chopped into small pieces. And the next step, what you are going to do is dry them away from sunlight. Don't directly keep them in sunlight, because some compounds may lose their potency. They may not work well when you check the efficacy of that particular compound, whether they are having an antimicrobial property or not. So always dry them away from the sunlight. Okay, so once the material gets dried, it may take around 2 days or sometimes 4-5 days as well. So once the material is dried, you can use a mortar and pestle, or you can grind them well into a fine powder. Okay, what you are doing, you have collected the leaf sample, you dried away from the sunlight. Once the material is dried, what you are going to do, you are making them into a fine powder. And then what you are going to do is take 10 grams of your powder, add it to the 100 ml of the solvent, any solvent of your choice. You can use methanol, you can use chloroform, you can use ethyl alcohol, you can use hexane, it depends. So based on the polarity of the solvent, the compounds will be liberated into your solvents. Okay, so you are adding 10 grams of that fine powder into a 100 ml of solvent, and then allow the extraction of bioactive compounds. Okay, you have to follow any of the methods for the purpose of extraction, and you have to carry out the process of extraction for 24 to 72 hours. So during this process, what happens, all the bioactive compounds will be liberated into the organic solvents. So the next step is rota evaporation. Okay, here in this step, what you are doing, you are adding the plant material to the solvent and allow it for the extraction. Then what you are going to do, you have to filter this solution. So the leaf material will be left over, and then you are going to collect the solvent with the bioactive compounds. That solvent should be subjected to the rota evaporation. That is, you are going to concentrate the material. So that material will be having a mixture of compounds. And then you again have to separate the compounds. You can go either with the column chromatography, or you can identify the compounds by TLC chromatography. Once you isolate the particular compound, you have to send it for the HPLC study to check the purity of the compound. And then you can go with the GC-MS and then NMR to find the structure of the compound. And now you want to detect whether that compound is having an antimicrobial property or not. So that pure form of the compound can be used to perform the MIC, as I already told you how to perform the MIC test. So for this MIC test, you already prepared the plant extract. Now you are having so after the rota evaporation, you are going to have a plant extract. that should be dissolved in DMS4 to the required concentration. Say for example, you have 500 mg per ml of your stock. This is your plant extract. Okay, earlier we have seen the serial dilution of the antibiotic, and here we are going to serially dilute the plant extract. The procedure will be the same. You are going to take 96 well microtiter plate, and in all the wells you are going to add the broth, MH broth. Okay, after the addition of the MH broth, what you are going to do? You are going to serially dilute the plant extract. So here you are taking a 500 mg of your plant extract. When you serially dilute, it becomes 250, 125, and then so on. So the highest concentration to the least concentration. Okay. So earlier you have serially diluted the antibiotic, and here with the plant extract for your research purpose, in the process of identifying a novel drug, what you are doing here? You are going to serially dilute the plant extract from the highest concentration to the least concentration. Again, you have to maintain positive control and the negative control. Choose some pathogenic strains like Klebsiella pneumonia, Escherichia coli, Staphylococcus aureus, and few more fungal strains as well. You can test against n number of pathogens with your single plant extract. Okay. So here the same thing. Next, what is the step? You are going to add inoculum. How much should be the inoculum added? The inoculum should be added at a concentration of 5 into 10 power 5 CFU per ml. Please check my earlier video, that is on MIC, for the better understanding of this concept. If you doesn't follow that video and come directly to this video, you may not understand. So please go through my video on MIC and then you check this video, so it will be very clear for you. So here I am applying both the AST and the MIC techniques for the purpose of research if you are working on plant extracts. Same as earlier, you have serially diluted with the antibiotic sample. Here you are going to serially dilute your antimicrobial compound, that is your compound extracted from the plant source. And here your aim is to identify whether that particular pure form of the compound isolated from the plant source is having an antimicrobial property or not. So this is also a protocol suggested by CLSI guidelines, where we are going to add MH broth to all the wells, followed by the addition of a antimicrobial compound with different concentration from the highest to the lowest, maintaining the positive control and the negative control, followed by the addition of the inoculum. This inoculum is your test pathogen or the test organism at a concentration of 5 into 10 power 5 CFU per ml. So the plant extract and the bacterial inoculum should be added at a concentration of 1:1, that is 100 microliters of the plant extract and the 100 microliters of the bacterial inoculum at a concentration of 5 into 10 power 5 CFU per ml. Then the next step is cover it up with the lid and then keep it in an incubator at 37 degrees centigrade overnight. So here comes the actual problem. Earlier it is easy for us that just when you lift up the plate, you can clearly see the deposition of the bacterial cells. But when it comes to the plant extracts are generally green in color due to the presence of a pigment called chlorophyll. So due to this presence of chlorophyll, you can see a green color solution in all the wells. And it will be difficult for you to identify the presence or the absence of the bacterial growth when you just lift up the plate. And even if you go for an ELISA reader, because of the plant extract, due to the green in color, you may get a higher absorbance than the actual. So at a higher concentration, the bacteria may not survive. It may get killed by the antimicrobial compound. But the absorbance will be more because the green color is high at the higher concentration compared to the lower concentration. So you may get the absorbance oppositely, means higher here and the lower here. But actually the bacterial count will be less here and more here. So the absorbance should be less here and more here. But with the presence of the chlorophyll, that is due to the green color pigment, the absorbance may give you more here compared to here. So to avoid that problem, when you specifically work with the plant extracts, you please incorporate an indicator dye called pido nitro tetrazoleum salts. So this is an indicated dye. So once after the process of incubation, just remove the plate and prepare a 2% of pido nitro tetrazoleum dye, and you add 40 microliters to all the wells. 40 microliters to be added to all the wells. As we are saying that it is an indicated dye, it will be usually colorless. But after a period of incubation for 30 minutes, if the bacteria is present in any well, the color of the media will change to pink. Hope you understand. Because this is an indicated dye, it is used to detect the presence or the absence of the growth of the bacteria. If there is a presence of the growth of the bacteria, when you add this indicated dye and keep it for 30 more minutes of incubation, you can observe the change in the color of the media from colorless to the pink. Usually your media color will be yellow because the MH broth will be yellow in color. But once you add this indicated dye, that will turn to a pink color. Why? Why? Because especially these tetrazoleum salts act by accepting electrons. Okay, these tetrazoleum salts act by accepting electrons and they get oxidized by the surviving bacteria. So whenever they get oxidized, what happens? They forms a colored product called Formazan. Hope you understand. Here we are going to identify the color change. Okay, as we had a problem with the green color, here we are going to identify the presence of the pink color or not with the addition of a indicated dye called pido nitro tetrazoleum salts. How these salts act is, they act by accepting the electrons. So they get oxidized by the surviving bacteria and they form a colored product called Formazan, which will be in a pink color. Okay, that is the reason we are going to identify for the pink color in the wells. If there is a presence of the pink color, means there the bacteria is surviving. That is the clear identification. For suppose here in all the wells I could see the pink color formation, but here at the concentration of 500 mg and 250 mg, there is no pink color. That clearly indicates that here there is no bacteria. Here there is the presence of bacteria and here there is an absence of the bacteria. Why? Because your particular antimicrobial compound that is isolated from the plant source is effective at these concentrations, and the MIC value will be 250 mg per ml. This is how you report an MIC value when you work with the plant extracts. Okay, if you are working with any antibiotic solution, there will be no problem because they are colorless solutions. You can clearly make out the presence or the absence of the growth. But coming to the plant extracts, they will be green in color because of the presence of chlorophyll. To differentiate the presence or the absence of the growth, what you are going to do is you are going to use an indicator dye called pido nitro tetrazoleum salts, and they act by accepting the electrons. So you can differentiate whether the media is colorless or it may turn to a pink color. Okay, so here this is how you report an MIC value. Hope you understand. Here at both the concentration the growth is inhibited, but for an MIC value your intention is to detect the least concentration of the drug which is going to effectively kill the test organism. So you are going to report the MIC value as 250 mg per ml against E. coli, whatever the test organism you used for the study. Okay, hope you understand this session, and this is how we apply these techniques as a part of preclinical studies. If you find difficulty in performing AST due to the diffusion problem, you can go with the MIC. This is the most accurate and the reliable method. You will get a good results when you perform an MIC in process of identifying a novel drug. So, I'm working in the research. you can work out on this concept, because nowadays the emergence of multi-drug resistant strains is a serious problem, and there is a need to identify novel drugs which can be used to combat these infectious diseases. So you can apply these techniques as a preclinical study, and you can further evaluate the efficacy of the drug with the further test. Hope you understand the session, and if you have any doubts, please leave your doubts in the comment section and I will get back to you. Thank you.